In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends, good morning to everyone and greetings on behalf of St. George's Cathedral. And I wish you all a very happy time of worship wherever you are. Today is a special Sunday, the Passion Sunday, on which we remember the cross of Christ and the sacrifice that he has made on the cross in order to save you and me from all our bondages. I would welcome you now to view and participate in the worship online. God bless you all.
Wait quietly for the Lord. Be patient till he comes. Blessed is anyone who trusts in the Lord and rests his confidence in him. Heal me and I shall be healed. Save me and I shall be saved. For you are my praise. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious, but in everything, make your requests known to God in prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Then the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, will guard your hearts and your thoughts in Christ Jesus. Almighty God, you know our thoughts and our desires, and no secret is hidden from you. By your Holy Spirit, prepare us now, so that we may love and worship you as we ought. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us all join in singing hymn 127 in the common praise, 127, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. We'll be following the order on page 15. Let us join in the Gloria together. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among all in whom he is well pleased. We praise you, we bless you, we worship you, we glorify you, We give thanks to you for your great glory, O Lord God, Heavenly King, God the Father Almighty. O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. You that take away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. You who sit at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For you only are holy, you only are the Lord, you only are the Most High, O Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us all join in the prayer of confession. May we all examine ourselves, examine our thoughts, and see if there is anything that stands as a barrier for the blessings of our Heavenly Father. We have come to hear God's word, to praise Him, and to share in the blessings of God. Let us call to mind our sins and our need of God's grace. Let us humbly confess to Almighty God. Let us follow the prayer found on page 16. Heavenly Father, we confess that we have sinned against you and our neighbor. We have walked often in darkness rather than in light. We profess to believe in Christ but continue to do evil. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us our sins. Grant us by your Holy Spirit to discern good from evil and to do only what is right. Enable us to forgive others, that with new life we may serve you and all people. Amen. This is the word of God in Christ to all who turn to Him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so that everyone who believes in Him may not perish, but may have eternal life. May the Almighty God have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The collect for this Sunday. God of all seasons, in your pattern of things, there is a time for keeping, a time for losing, a time for building up, and a time for pulling down. In this holy season of Lent, as we journey with our Lord to the cross, help us to discern in our lives what we must lay down and what we must take up, what we must end and what we must begin. Lord, give us grace to lead a disciplined life in glad obedience and with the joy which comes from a closer walk with you. In Jesus' name we humbly pray. Amen. May we all listen to the reading of the gospel.
Hear the word of God as it is written in the gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 to 45. Mark, chapter 10, 35 to 45. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." And Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink? Are we baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They replied, We are able. Then Jesus said to them, The cup that I drink, you will drink, and the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared. When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become a great among you, you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you, you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Here ends the reading of the gospel lesson. Praise be to you, O God. Amen.
We listen to the word of God.
Let us pray. May the meditation of our hearts and the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Dear friends, the parishioners and the members of St. George's Cathedral, I give thanks to God for this opportunity of sharing God's word through the media, and I thank God for this facility with which we as a church together renew our fellowship with each other by listening and viewing to this worship online. Passion Sunday is one of the important Sundays during the season of Lent. And on this Sunday, we think about the sufferings of Christ, the sacrifice that he has made. And we appreciate the passion with which Jesus had surrendered himself to undergo any amount of suffering that he had to face, because it was the will of the Father. On this Sunday, in our meditation, I would like to identify three images of the cross of Christ in the Bible. The first one is the universal cross. Psalm 103 verses 11 and 12 depicts an image of cross. Psalm 103 verse 11 reads like this: For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. And verse 12, As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. In these two verses, we have the image of the cross of Christ. Verse 11 talks about the distance between the earth and the heaven. The distance between the heaven and the earth is equal to the amount of love that God would show to his people. And in verse 12, we read about the distance between the east and the west, and it is equal to the forgiveness that God gives to his children. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions, that means is forgiveness. So the distance between the earth and the heaven is compared to the love of Christ, and the distance between the east and the west is equaled to the forgiveness of Christ. When we draw two lines, one from the earth to heaven and the other from east to west, we will get the image of a cross. And we can also imagine that the cross is made of two beams, the straight beam and the horizontal beam. According to these verses in Psalm 103, the straight beam represents the love of God, and the horizontal beam represents the forgiveness of God. Therefore, the cross is the embodiment of the love of God and the forgiveness of God. And in this situation, this is the first cross that we need to identify. We are now in need of God's love and God's forgiveness. And where can we get it? It is through the cross of Christ, on which Christ sacrificed himself. He shed his blood and he demonstrated his love for the whole of humanity. When someone asked Jesus, "How much do you love the world?" he wanted to demonstrate it by stretching his hands out. And he stretched his hands out as far as he could, and the people nailed his hands on the cross. That is how Christ demonstrated his love on the cross for the whole of humanity. And his forgiveness is also available to all of us who turn to him during pain, problem, sickness, and diseases of any kind. And today, the situation that we are going through will remind us that we are away from the presence of God. Therefore, we are longing for the love of God, and we are in need of the forgiveness of God. And today, let us realize where we are and turn to Jesus and look at his cross. And these verses remind us that the steadfast love of God and the forgiveness of Jesus, they are made available through the cross of Christ. And this universal cross, which we can identify in these verses, as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our sins and our transgressions. These verses identify the universal cross of Christ from which the world can receive love and forgiveness from God. And Psalm 130 verse 5 says, "If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you." And Romans 5:8 defines, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." So this is the message of the universal cross. There is love and forgiveness on everyone who turns to cross. Second image of cross that we have in the scripture is found in Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. Galatians 2:20, I read it for you. St. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life that I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Cross is the symbol of unselfishness and humility. Like St. Paul, all of us have been crucified with Christ. Our self had perished and died. Christ lives in everyone. As we have already seen, the cross is made of two big beams, one straight and one horizontal. Here in this verse from Galatians 2:20, there is an image of Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. I want your attention on this single letter I. It is no longer I, but it is Christ who lives in me. If you detach one beam from the cross, the horizontal beam is detached, then you will have the straight beam, which can also mean the big I, representing the self, the ego, which is the cause for all evil in everyone. Those who boast about their self can never say, I no longer live. Neither they can say, Christ lives in me. There is no place for Christ in their hearts. Their ego is at their center. But through Paul, we understand that we can cancel our ego. We can do away with our I-ness and say, it is no longer I, but Christ who lives in me. How Christ makes the cross unselfish is by canceling the I, by giving his own life on the cross. And when we look at the cross, the horizontal beam is the canceling of the big I, which is the ego or the self that has been canceled by the humility of Jesus. The horizontal beam cancels the I and the self, and thus Christ presents an unselfish cross for all of us. Therefore, we need to understand that what is fundamental to the cross and its universal efficacy is the aspect of self-emptying, which all of the theologians call as kenosis, meaning I empty. So on this day of Passion Sunday, we need to cancel our I and say, I empty myself. It is no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 onwards, we read, though he was in the form of God, he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. This is how Christ would present to each one of us an unselfish cross. The cross, which is unselfish, has the message for all of us this morning. The message is, empty yourself. Empty your ego and put Christ into you, so that we can together say, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. There is a story of three believers, a Roman Catholic believer, a Protestant believer, and a Pentecostal believer, arguing with each other as to who will go to heaven. The Roman Catholic believer first said, I only will go to heaven, because ours is the early church, and we also give importance to Mary. So it is I who can go to heaven. But then the Protestant disagreed. He said, no, you cannot go to heaven. I am the Protestant. I only go to heaven because we give much importance to the Bible and also to the Holy Sacrament. So it is I who can go to heaven. The third believer, the Pentecostal believer, he relented very strongly. No, no, both of you could never enter heaven. Only I could do that. I can go to heaven because I have taken immersion baptism. I speak in tongues. I have the Holy Spirit in me. Therefore, only I can go to heaven. This argument was going on for some time. They were fighting with each other, defending their faith and the tradition they follow. But a small boy was watching their argument and the fight that went on between them. And he came near and told them, none of you will go to heaven. None of you, no one will go to heaven. If I go, you will go, he said. They were confused. What do you mean? You will go? If I go, he again repeated, if I go, you will go. And then he made it very clear by saying, if that ego, if that I goes away from you, you will go to heaven. So when we think about the unselfish cross today, we see the humility of Christ, who is like a lamb, has committed himself on the cross to be sacrificed and to provide a ransom for all of us. So we have identified the universal cross, from which we have the love of God and the forgiveness of God. And secondly, we have identified the unselfish cross, through which we learn the lesson of emptying ourselves and becoming humble in our daily life. Now thirdly and finally, let us identify another cross in the Bible. The unique cross. I read Mark chapter 10, verse 25. where it says the Son of Man came not to be served but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The Son of Man came to be served but to serve, and in that service he gave his whole life as a propitiation for our sins. He gave his life as a ransom for many. And there is nothing else that we need to do. And there is nothing else that anyone else can do, because Christ, who came to serve the humankind, in his service, he gave his whole life as a ransom for many. Therefore, the cross becomes very unique by that very act of sacrifice. And the uniqueness of the cross is seen in its finality. Today we turn to the cross not as one of the many options, but as the only option through which we can be redeemed. The cross is the only means of our redemption. And on the cross, Jesus offered himself in our place, and he bore the consequences of our sin, thereby restoring us to fellowship with God. And that sacrifice is made once for all, and that is the final sacrifice. And that makes the cross of Christ unique among anything else that can provide salvation. The uniqueness of Christ is its finality, in which we have the sacrifice, the final one atoning sacrifice, once for all made for the deliverance of the humankind. This is what also we read in our prayer books every Sunday. One oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. He finished everything on the cross. He made the salvation possible by his sacrifice on the cross. Therefore, the cross of Christ is very unique. Martin Luther's life is an example of how he was always depending on the blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of his sins. It is said that in one of his writings, Martin Luther found himself being attacked by Satan in a dream. The devil unrolled a long scroll containing a list of Luther's sins and held it before him. On reaching the end of the scroll, Luther asked the devil, "Is that all?" "No," came the reply, and a second roll was thrust in front of him. Then after a second came a third. But now the devil had no more. And then Martin Luther began to speak. He says, "You have forgotten something. Quickly write on all the lists that you have showed me. Quickly write on each of them, the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sins." Now, we are in the midst of a terrible tragedy and the chaos that we are going through, and we feel sorry for the people who are suffering very much, and we also need to pray for them in their suffering. and extend as much as possible the support in whichever way we can. In this situation, is there a message from the church to the people who are suffering? Yes, there is a message. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, Peter declares, Jesus himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. By his wounds, you have been healed. This is the message that we have cherished so long, and we need to give this message to our neighbors as well. In Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4 and 5, surely you took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. This is my suggestion today to everyone who is listening to this sermon. Let us personalize these words for our own situation. Then the words would read like this: surely he took up my pain and bore my suffering. He was pierced for my transgressions. He was crushed for my iniquities. The punishment that brought me peace was on him, and by his wounds I am healed. This is how we can personalize God's word to our situation today and enjoy the healing power of the Christ who gave his life as a ransom for many on the cross, and thus made the cross so unique for all of us. COVID-19. This is the explanation that I want to give. Cross offers victory in death. That is COVID. Christ offers victory in death. We are all now fearful. We are in anxiety, and people live in nightmare as to what and when they will be infected and affected by this contagious disease that is around us. But COVID, to us who look at the cross and the sacrifice of Jesus, would mean cross offers victory in death. Therefore, there is always life in Christ for all of us. I want to close with a small illustration. Many years ago, a father and his daughter were walking through the grass in a forest. And at the distance, they saw a very wild fire approaching them. And they realized that it would soon engulf them. The father knew there was only one way of escape. They would quickly begin a fire right where they were and burn a large patch of grass. When the huge fire drew near, they then would stand on the section that had already burned. When the flames actually did approach them, the girl was terrified, but her father assured her, "The flames cannot get to us, my daughter, because we are standing where the fire has already been. We are standing where the fire has already come Therefore, the flames can never touch us. This is the message that we need to keep in our hearts today. We are already standing in a place where the fire has already been. That means the fire of God, the power of God, and the blood of Jesus have washed us, they have cleansed us, and they have made us pure. And we are standing in a safe place. And no flames can never touch us. With this hope, let us come near the cross and submit our lives to Him. With the realization that everything that is happening today is because we have gone astray from God like lost sheep. And if only we could come back to Christ on this cross, He would heal us through His wounds. Therefore, there is no fear and there is no panic. But let us know Christ and know His peace in our life. Amen.
Let us all join in affirming our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, found on page 18. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Banns of marriage. We published the banns of marriage between S. Adwina Mary Jasper, daughter of Mr. D. Stephen and Mrs. S. Surnam, members of our church, and S. Alexander Abraham, son of Mr. Soundra Pandian and Mrs. Aruna Pandian, members of Victorious Cross Church, Ashok Nagar. This is the first time of publishing. We publish the banns of marriage between Kenneth Layard, son of Mr. Cecil and Mrs. Susan, members of CSI Robertson Memorial Church, Coimbatore Diocese, and Susan Leonard, daughter of Dr. Leonard Abraham and Mrs. Rani Leonard, members of CSI House of Prayer, Adyar. This is a third party marriage. The wedding will be conducted in our church on the 30th of April. Friends, if any of you know any just cause as why these persons should not be united in this holy matrimony, you ought to declare it in writing to the presbyter in charge of this congregation. We would also like to read the names of those who are celebrating their birthday this week. Mr. Gerald Johnston, Mr. Ashok Kumar, Mr. Ralph Moses, Mr. Bobby Sharma, Ms. Aditi Deborah Chakravarti, Mr. K. Rajit Singh, Andrew Johan, Mr. Ruben Burby, Preetam Kevin, Mrs. Renuka Benjamin, Mr. Jay Chandran Asirvadam, Ms. Adeline Ashok Kumar, Mrs. Preetika Susanna Chandran, Mr. G. Jnanasegar Devadasan, Mr. Samson Sham, Mrs. Nalini Rajakumar, Mr. Alfred Rajasegaran, Ms. K. Mary Rebecca, Mr. George Cherian, Mrs. Mercy Chitra Sundaram, Mr. G. Livingston V. Jim, Mr. Deepak John, Mrs. J. Esther Helen Ruby, Mr. Rudolph De Silva, Master Esra Balasundaram, Mr. K. Paul Bentick, Mrs. Ashalata Chinnathambi, Mr. P. G. Santosh Kumar, Ms. Amuda Porkodi, Mr. Jnana Pragasam, Dr. G. John Samuel, Mrs. R. T. Ashalata, Ms. Sarah Sanjana Sundar, Ms. Divya Miriam Reynes, Ms. S. Andrina, Daryl Connie, Mr. Shatrak George Thibble, Mr. S. Ebenezer Emmanuel, Emmanuel Jason Kenny, Vivan Sam Srinivasan. Family which celebrates the wedding anniversary, Mr. and Mrs. Emmanuel Vikram. Let us pray. God, our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of thanksgiving. Every good and perfect gift comes from you. We thank you, Lord, for these our friends whom we have named, who celebrate their birthday this week and also celebrate the wedding anniversary. Thank you for adding one more year in their lives and your assurance of your goodness and favor which will rest upon them. Continue to be their shepherd and master of their life and help them to move forward with confidence that your choices, blessings rest upon them. We commit all of them. We also commit the bands that have been read. Bless the families and bless the people whom you have chosen to unite. Lord, let your hand be upon everything that they undertake, and may their wishes and wants be fulfilled according to your will and purpose. We commit all of us and this time of thanksgiving into your almighty hands. And we ask this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Dear friends, I once again greet all of you. And I am really glad that we could use this media to reach our members and present you a short worship in which you can participate. I hope you had the feeling of participating in the worship and praising God. Let us thank God together for this facility which we can use nowadays. We may have to depend on this facility for some more time till the situation returns to normalcy. But I believe everyone is praying, and the believers in every church, they are all praying for the soon restoration of normal life. And in the time to come, we'll be able to praise God for the wonder that we see during these days in our lives. As we have participated in the worship, we cannot provide you with all the elements of worship, but only a few with which we can feel that we have offered worship to God. And this is also a suggestion that if any of you would like to give offerings to the church, you can do so. The bank details would be given to you on screen. Please take note of the details of the bank. And if you want to give your offerings by way of subscription or general offertory, you can do so. It will directly go to the bank and you will be given the receipt. All the details will be available on the screen. Please watch the screen and take all the details down and follow the instructions. And if you want to offer to God and to his mission, this is the time that you can do so. And along with this, I also would like to request you that as far as possible, help people who are in need, who are suffering, who are homeless, people who need food, and various other needs. If you come across people with suffering and with need, it is always an opportunity for all of us to extend the love of Christ to every one of them. Once again, I greet you all, and I wish you all good health. Be safe at home. Keep good health. God bless you all. Amen.
Let us all join in singing hymn 385, Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious fountain. Jesus Christ, we are strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Disconcerted by the world's violence and its sorrow, distracted by our inward doubts and fears. Father, wherever we are or on this day's journey, breathe on us your gentle spirit, that we may be oases of quietness and refreshment, bringing to your uneasy world reconciliation and peace. God Almighty, your beloved Son, for love of us, willingly offered himself to endure the cross, its agony and shame. God, remove from us all coldness and give us grace to take up your cross and take up our own crosses and follow him in humility and love. We ask all this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Let's join in the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, holy be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the test, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us commit our lives to God and remain as God's instruments in his hand. And in God's name, have courage, hold on to what is good, return no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering. Honor all people, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, loving and almighty, we praise you and thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ, who came into this world as a healer body and soul. We look up to you and to your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the head of our church. In this time of distress and death, we look up to your loving kind embrace and assurance. We lift up in prayer all those who are affected by the coronavirus, and especially those who are in the quarantine. May your healing presence be with them and help them to recover, to be united with their families. We pray for all the families who have lost their loved ones during this pandemic. Console them with your tender voice. We pray for all the world leaders who are leading their countries in the effort to contain the pandemic. We especially pray for the healthcare workers and the other essential service providers who are working. May they be protected from their infections. Dear Lord, we pray for those who are affected by this long curfew. We pray for those who have lost their livelihood. Help us to extend our helping hands to the homeless, poor, and hungry people. During this time of travail, help the churches to respond to the pandemic with Christian care and concern for those who are affected. We pray in the healing name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak and help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.